Hey folks, I hope we're live, and today I've got all the parts that I need to build a gravel bike, today will be, you know, due to popular requests from friends and all that, gonna try to do a live stream of building a bike, the gravel bike. I figured that since it's a very rare opportunity, not just for me, but for some folks who are keen on the Canon Grail, which is, I've got the CF carbon fiber version, SL8.0. So I'm going to try to do a live build of this gravel bike, very popular with Singaporeans. We've seen quite a few around, but to get a bike is actually very value for money. Given the parts that you get, it's pretty high spec for what you pay for. The problem tends to be that it's very hard to get available slot to book and buy the bike. So often, more than not, it's very hard to get the ability to actually even book the bike. So I've been very fortunate. I booked this Canon Grail CF SL 8.0 on 7 July. I was just trying my luck on the website, and lo and behold, small, which is very unusual, small happens to be 1.75. I'm about 1.75 meters in height, and in for this bike, small is supposed to be my size. So happened to see an available slot and immediately just booked it. You know, it's been eyeing for it for a while. Some of you might have known that I actually had the SS version, which I got off Carousel, but it was too small for me, and after riding it was quite difficult. I felt like throwing up because, you know, the posture is all wrong. So I managed to actually get the small version, which is supposed to be my size. So today I'm going to try and build it. I've technically got till midnight, so it's about just 2 hours 15 minutes for me to build this. I don't know if I can pull it off, but I'm going to try. So part of this is also recording to try and archive the method that I followed instructions to put it together. And, you know, it's a learning opportunity for both you and I. Alright, so let's give it a shot. Okay, so when you order it, it comes in a box like this. And this is what they call bike guard. I'm always amazed by the Germans because the unboxing and my experience for this is seriously hardcore. It's amazing. You know, you really get what you pay for, or a little bit more. So, interestingly, I mean, this is just an ordinary box, right? But the same box is what you use to actually assemble the bike. So this box actually protects the bike and serves as a bike stand for you to assemble the bike. So you see in a while, once I open it up, that this thing is actually sort of like a DIY bike stand as well. I'll just show you a few more other custom parts that I've ordered in because, you know, I'm picky like that. So let me just show you what else I've got. Okay, so now actually the bike parts are pretty solid. You've got Schwabe G1 bike, about 38C to 40C tires with 700 circumference there. And those are good enough, and it's pretty fast rolling. But you know, because I've seen incredible reviews for this particular Pirelli tire, this is the Pirelli Cinturello Gravel, and specifically there's two versions of this. There's the hard terrain and mixed terrain. The mixed terrain one, the treads, the knob is more knobby, so it's better for all kinds of terrain. And then the hard terrain one, which is this version, is more fast rolling. And on the road, it will be even more fast rolling. In fact, what's interesting is that some of the reviewers for this brand new kind of tire actually said that this was hilariously fast. So I'm curious how hilarious it will be, but I don't mind the speed. So, and also because I love fat bikes, all my bikes, they tend to have very wide tires. I even did up my Brompton to have the fattest tire possible without modifying the frame. because I love the plush ride, you know, and all that. So while the bike comes standard stock with the Shelby G1 bike at about 38 to 40 C, you notice that I happen to get the 700C by 45, and the Canyon Grail limit is actually about 42. But on Reddit, the Canyon Grail forum for on Reddit, some people have pushed it to the 45 limit. So we'll see. There's a lot of variables to this, depending on your rim width and all that. Then it really depends whether it will work. But we'll just have to give it a shot. A lot of it's got to do experimentation. So. And I love the idea that I purposely got black instead of the tan wall, which is super popular, I know. But I'm getting black because I've got solid black rims, and together with this black tie and black rims, it'll make the bike look quite sleek and a bit fatty. So it, to me, it looks quite nice. It should look quite nice. So we'll see. Alright? So let's start putting together. Also, one more custom part, of course. Most of the time when you buy a new bike, right, you won't get pedals, because pedals, as you know, is a very personal thing. And I've been using this Spank pedals on my Surly Moon Lander. Love it, it's a beautiful set of pedals. But they stopped making it for a while. And it just so happened that when I was about to build this bike, this went up on Amazon for about $130. Very reasonable for pretty good pedals, yeah. And this is what they call the reboot version. The reboot version, right, they did a new version, just came out, and instead of the usual dual tone color, right, this is in solid black. So this is the Spank Spike pedal. And those of you who are into pedals will be familiar with the Crank Brothers Stamp 1 to Stamp 7, that kind of thing. Or even the 1-Up pedal, which is very beautiful and minimalist. This is kind of like in between, and this time around they make it super subtle. You can see the branding etched in, but other than that, it's pure, you know, very very solid flat piece. And flat pedals are the in thing now. In the past, people had the clip-ons and all that. You know, you lock in your shoes with the clipless pedals. But flat is the way to go, because especially with gravel, you have to, you know, shift your footing around quite a lot due to the, you know, different terrain you're gonna face. The only thing I wish was that I could, if only I could get all the parts fully blacked out instead of all these silvery parts. But obviously, I can always color it and all that. But otherwise, pretty good set that I'm looking forward to installing. So we'll come to this part probably in the last few steps. Okay? Alright, so we're going to start. So here's the exciting part. So to give you a full experience, I only noticed on the top here, there are two of these tabs. Again, part of the beautiful unboxing experience, these tabs, you rotate them to unlock. All right? So I'm going to rotate them, and then they come off. And now I'm going to open it up so you see how impressive it is, okay? So it comes off like, oops, I hit it the wrong way, sorry. Let me rotate it. Okay, so I'm gonna open it up, starts like this, enjoy the ride. Then after that, it folds out a little bit, like so. Okay. So you can see already off the bat, very well done. I mean, how many bike unboxings can you say that, you know, it's so well put together? It's like the Apple or the IKEA of bicycles, if anything, right? Okay, so one of the first few things we'll take out is accessory box. It's empty right now, but sometimes when you order spare parts or whatnot, they'll put it inside this box, right? I did order some small things, not worth mentioning. So let's put this one aside. Okay, so there is one more box here. I just want to show you there are like a few parts inside, right? There's one more box here which contains all the other accessories. And to help you pull it out, they actually got a tab for you to pull. So you see this? I'm going
know, this thing is quite heavy. But it's heavy because of one reason, I'll show you why. So let's get started. This is the starting the box to start off with, because it contains things like the instruction manual and all that. Alright, so just to show you, showing you guys all these things will really take longer for me to build the bike, but I thought I'd show it to you. So you open a box, you know, there's a quick start guide. There's even a musette here, which is a cyclist bag for you to sling over yourself. So this is a nice gift for you. So you take this away. The quick start guide is illustrated, so you know, doesn't matter what language you speak or read, it's all visual, so it's very easy. So we'll use this in a while. Comes with assembly paste. Now this is a kind of grease, actually more like a friction kind of like a greasy thing. The friction thing is for you to apply around certain moving parts, for example the stem and other parts which the manual will state, so that it helps hold the certain parts together. There's even a torque wrench here. Now if you know your stuff, right, you do a bit of shopping, torque wrenches which lets you calibrate the newtons or the force applied to a screw, especially for carbon parts, right? The torque screw can be very expensive actually, but they actually figured out how to make it affordable and give you one in a box. And then all the little screw heads are here, the pegs and all that, the hex screws, they're all here, right? And if you take this off, out slowly, you'll see that, let me put this down. This is the reason why it's so heavy. This is a manual for a road bike, and it has everything you need to know about putting your bike together and all that stuff. So this thing is like pretty crazy. One reason why it's so thick is because it's in multiple languages. So it's almost like a phone book or a Bible. But I guess you can use this for bedtime reading if you want. Now the other side here is a little bag full of other accessories, right? And what's interesting is there's reflectors and all kinds of odds and ends which I don't know if I've got time to get into, but yeah, it's parts that come with your wheel and other parts that they put together. So, you know, I don't know if we'll get to this, but we'll see. Alright, so these are just the manuals for the wheel rims and other parts. Okay, I'm putting this away so that I can get started. Let me just clear up the space a little bit. Okay, I hope you guys can hear me well, because I can't really see the comments or whatnot. I'm just doing this casually. So, okay, so quick start guide. This is where we start. Okay, let me just. So, this is what you kind of get, right? They give you all this stuff here. Okay. So the top wrench is here. Then you supply your own pedals and some of the other tools for you to attach the pedals. They've got the friction gel or whatever. And of course you need your own pump. And if you've got grease, that's useful for the pedals when you apply. So you can see that the next few steps involves us lifting the bike, putting it down, taking off the Velcros and whatnot. And then, starting to assemble some of the pieces. So at this point, right, I might not narrate so much. I'll just start building, because it'll take too much effort. If you can hear me, I'll kind of explain what I'm doing. Okay, so let's give it a shot. I'm just going to take a set of tools with me. Start. So this is the front wheel. Alright, let's just put it down. Oh, it appears to be quite fully inflated, which is puzzling to me because usually when you air travel a bike, right, you really usually deflate the tires, so it's quite dangerous for you to enter different air pressures when you're dealing with it. Oh yeah, in the box also it comes with this protection stickers, so when you do mount frame bags, handlebar bags, you won't damage the carbon frame. Okay, so here are some frame stickers. But you know, typical Singaporeans, you know what they'll do, and I'll probably follow suit. You go to those car detailing workshops, right? And there's one that everybody goes to called Wright School. And for $250 to $300, their experts will apply a protection film covering your entire frame. So being kiasu a bit, right? Rather than you pasting at different parts of the bike, you can just protect majority of the frame if you go there. It's not cheap, but it's worry-free, right? It's supposed to be self-healing. If you scratch, then you won't damage the actual frame. That thing will absorb the damage and all that stuff. So it's a kind of like insurance that a lot of people go through. So if you have a carbon bike, the trade-off is you want light, you want fast, but it's a bit more fragile, right? Unlike other metals. So that's the thing that you trade off. But some people, I've ridden quite a few bikes. Carbon has that beautiful, magical nature, and everybody will have their own thing. Some people love titanium, some people love carbon, but recently I tried carbon and it's amazing. Okay, it's almost magical, it's almost like super light. Okay, so next, this is the seat. Let me see. So this seat post, so I got the SL8 version, and the seat post is one of the reasons why I go SL8 instead of SL7, okay? It's a bit like buying Mercedes lah, you get a bit more premium. The seat post is not ordinary, okay? You know, this is something interesting. There's a splinter joint here, and the idea is, because gravel is rough, right, on rough terrain, the idea is this thing can swivel back and forth. This is carbon. This is a carbon seat post. And the way it's done up, it's like two bones that can swivel, so your seat can kind of rock a little bit. Now, day to day, you won't be able to see this thing rock back and forth, lah. But it's supposed to be quite subtle, so it's not super terrifying or whatever. You know, it's not going to snap or whatever. It's pretty well built, lah. Like I said, the keyword here is subtle, lah. So, and then if you're curious, right, from the earlier Canyons to the later ones, they changed the seat, the saddle. So just to show you a little bit, I prefer this saddle. The older one looks a bit cheap, lah. This is a much nicer saddle, and the angular design matches the angularity of the frame. Later when you see the frame, you know what I mean, lah. So the aesthetic is pretty similar, and it's by Physique. Probably a German brand as well. And you can see the padding on the sides here. It's pretty soft. And then the cutouts in the middle. Typically for the high-end bikes, you know, the idea is save weight, that's one. But the other one is that this allows either side of the saddle to flex independently as well. So your backside, you know, when you're rocking, when you're cycling, right? Different parts of the thigh bone will hit. So the saddle is supposed to flex as well. But have to see, you know. Overall, at least it looks matching with the bike frame, as you'll see in a while. So I'll put this one side. Okay, this looks like a main entree. Okay, so at this point, right? Okay, based on the instructions, that's how they tell you to put it. You're using this part of the box as the stand as you assemble the bike. So that's why they said, you know, this box itself is quite a interesting piece of work. And the box is now technically empty. This is it really. So I've taken out most of the stuff. Let me see what's next. So take it out, lay it on the top, and then, okay. So we're gonna start to take off all the pieces. Okay, so just a bit about the build. You're looking at a GRX 800. You know, there's a 600, there's an 800. And the idea here is that it's almost like, if you're familiar with the Shimano and all that stuff, it's like Dior, Tiagra, and GRX 800, which is what this build comes with. It's almost like the, what's that? Is it Ultima? What's that? I forgot the name of that grade, but it's one of the higher end grades that comes with it. Now, I wouldn't mind getting the lower grade, but you know, sometimes it's a stock and availability that makes it challenging. Okay. So what you see here, right, is that because they have to fit it in the box, oh, there's one more set of instructions about fixing the stem. Okay, because it comes in a box like this, you have to assemble the handlebar perpendicular to the frame naturally. Okay, so right now for packaging purposes, they put it on the side. So I'm gonna start unraveling this. There's a little Velcro, I think. This is a Velcro. Trying to figure it out. I'm gonna have to cut it off. I think it's Velcro. Very strong Velcro. Okay. So when you purchase the bike, right, sometimes this is scary part. Hopefully everything checks out fine. So yeah, what you see here is Velcro and foam padding. Very dense foam padding, so that protected the frame a little bit. I'm just gonna chuck it in here. Lots of warning stuff. There's a lot of things going on, so I'm still kind of like processing what the heck all these things are. Okay, I need some scissors or something. Give me a sec. Okay, I put them. So far, is everything okay? Can you all hear me? Just type if you can hear me, just say okay and all that stuff. At least I know. Meanwhile, I'm looking for the scissors. I don't know if the AirPods that I'm wearing, I'm hoping that it's actually transmitting the audio, but I don't know if it's the mic that's on this iPad or is it coming from my AirPods. So I had to wait 2 months, that's the average. I booked it on 7 July and it came a few days ago. So now it's about August 20th, I think. This is a size S, which is suitable for my height of 1.75 meters. I think I'm going to skip the AirPods. I don't know if it's making a difference. Probably going to be the onboard mic, if not mistaken. Okay, hope you guys can still hear me. If possible, try to say yes or no, then at least I know. Thanks. I'm just removing the handlebar. which is kind of taped with the fork of the bike.
And there's one more Velcro and foam here. There's a very interesting cardboard attached to the front fork. Sort of like the, there's a mount between the fork where the wheel is supposed to go. And this is cardboard that explains the spacing between the different bike models. I'm not sure what this is for actually, but we'll see. Maybe for the hiking purposes. So there's one more Velcro here with foam. Which attaches the handlebar to the fork. I think once I get this off, yeah, technically releases from the fork. So this is where it starts to get interesting, because I start to have to mount this beautiful handlebar, which is a signature element of the Canyon Grail. If you don't really know, it's what they call a hoverbar, right? So it's two bars, and the reason why, at least from their perspective, is that it's to absorb the bumps that you face. So you mostly be on the uppers here, holding it, and by having the dual handlebar, this thing absorbs the bumps. So if anything, it looks nice lah. It's aero, it's a flat bar. But it makes the Canyon Grail look the way it is, right? It's a very special kind of look and feel. Okay, so I'm gonna figure this part out. There's a tape here where this stem goes. I'm trying to see what this warning sticker is about. There's some illustration on the tape. Not sure if you can see it. It's a bit hard. Yeah. Saying to put some. There's something that I'm supposed to put. Some orange thing. Was it something? I'm supposed to take it out, is it? Not sure, I have to read the instructions. Okay, cutting off another label here that says that the brakes are self-adjusting, so do not actually brake lever when wheel is dismounted. So I guess once the wheel is mounted, then you can squeeze the brakes to have it self-adjust. Page here, you can see so far I'm doing it right, and I have to do the stuff in the middle now. There's a bit of that friction gel or grease that I'm supposed to apply to the stem mount, and then I have to use the torque screw to apply a certain amount of pressure or force to the screwing part. So I have to try and focus a bit.
So they call, this is the paste they provide.
Okay, so again, it's so proper, right? They provide all this stuff for you, so you don't have to buy.
Okay, so just to show you, this is the top screw, and you can see the Newton force to select over here, and you move it to adjust accordingly, and then here are all the assembly heads. Okay. Supposed to just release that. Oh, release this. I'm supposed to release. Oh, maybe that's for a different bike. Some messages, give me a sec. Okay. So yeah, so the instruction manual is for, looks like it's not just for the Grail, it's actually for their range of bikes, so you have to make sure you're reading the correct one. Okay, so interesting, because this bike has an integrated handlebar, right? We're not looking at this one where you have to mount the stem and all that stuff. This one is all integrated, so apparently there's a kind of, I don't know, some safety plastic thing in there to take out, and then you start applying, and then you just slip it in and you screw it in. So okay, I see it. So there's a little plastic thing here. Oh, it comes off pretty easily. Inside that handlebar stem area, there's this plastic, I think a protector of some sort. Oh wait, you're supposed to leave it on. Okay, you leave it on, apply the friction paste, and then you screw it in. Okay. I'm just trying to figure out, yeah, like cables, and I want to make sure I put it in the cables in the correct direction. I guess this is correct. I know it's hard for you all to see, but I guess it's correct because along the handlebar on the inside there's protection frame stickers. So I guess the cables are supposed to run on the inside here. Okay. And now I'm going to remove this top part with this thing. Let's see. Okay. So I'm going to use this tool and remove this top. So this is a stem cap. And this bike, I know it's still protected by styrofoam, so you can't really see the frame. Maybe that's part of the mystery. I'm just going to do this part first. And let me remove this stem cap, then slip the handlebar on. Again, I hope you guys can hear me. If not, just, I don't know, have a message, let me know. Am I getting it out? Yeah, I think it's coming out. Just, you know, this is probably very long. Okay, so this is the cap. Just to show you guys, this is the stem cap.
You know, again, it's a carbon fully integrated handlebar with the frame. This whole thing is super, super integrated. That's why it's a thick sports car. It looks very different from just normal bikes, like.
Okay. So next part is I'm supposed to apply this casing. So they
call it assembly paste, but some call it friction paste.
So let's try it out. Let me get some tissue just in case my hands get dirty. Save some for other parts later as well. I saw in the manual, so you know, don't want to just do too much. I don't know how much to apply, I'm just applying as much. It's almost like sunscreen, and I'm just applying it generously all over. Okay, I think that's down, and it's a bit dirty. Yeah, this paste is a bit sandy. So it's sticky but sandy at the same time. It's interesting. Okay, so I did that. Now what? Okay, so I'm gonna put this on. aside from the stem cap, which you saw just now, behind here, there are two more. Behind, when you turn the steering wheel with the rear facing up, there's two more areas to screw down. Let me check. Okay, let me, it says to put on the cap first, tighten, then tighten the other two parts. So let me take this. This is the stem cap. Okay. Honestly, as I do this, right, even though this top screw has a kind of metering at the side, the manual doesn't state how much Newton force I'm supposed to calibrate it to, so I'm just gonna tighten but not over tighten. Newton meters in terms of force or something. Yeah. try and remove this head here. I'm gonna use a thicker head here to get in there, but I'm trying to figure out which one. Until this, there's this pin here that's pointing at the amount of force, so right now it's at 0, and if I turn until it hits 7, I guess that's where I'll stop. So it's loose for now. It's going in, I can feel it. And now it's stuck in tension, and if I turn, I can see this starting to reflect the kind of force level, but I'm not very sure what's going on. As I turn this, I think I see the pin sort of like moving towards the where it's ought to go. Okay, I don't dare to push any further, but basically this pin moves along this dial, and 7 is somewhere in the middle, but I'm like maybe one third in, but I'm not going to risk it, okay? Because it looks pretty sandwiched in already. I don't want to push it any further. Last thing I want is to break the carbon and then like game over. Okay, handlebar is on now. Let's see what else. Now it's the saddle and the seat post. So using that same paste. Oh wait, different bike again. So they show a few different bikes here, so I have to make sure I got the right one. Let's take the rest of this off. Okay, so here's the seat post. Now the very interesting thing about the seat post here is that you know most normal bikes they have a seat collar and you can buy that, or it's like a different piece here that you tighten. But because it's a fully integrated design bike, right? There's a little knob here that you use your screwdriver, your hex screwdriver to kind of like turn. Tighten the bolt that goes in, so it then sort of like acts as a friction against your seat post. So it's kind of like here is where you tighten to adjust how high and low your seat post is to be. So So let me just check the instruction manual if there's anything unique that I need to do. Because they have a few versions of bike mentioned here. They appear to ask the user to apply the friction paste on this interior section here. I don't know if I should do the same, but intuitively, if that applies to the other bikes, I would think that it applies here as well. So I'm gonna try and put some of the paste in there. This is the part instructions where it's not very clear, so I'll kind of show you. You can see that they got a few different models of bikes. And you see this picture in the middle where it shows the friction paste, right? Then they kind of like rub it inside the seat post area. But for the other versions, they didn't mention it. And even for this Canyon Grail, it's not really mentioned. But I guess it's logical that if it applies to one of their bikes, it applies to this one as well. So, I still have plenty of that assembly paste. They call it assembly paste here. But basically, oh, it says here, interesting. So assembly paste for carbon and alloy components, I'll read it out to you. It says microparticles increase friction. So it's a bit like, you know those soap or shampoo with the micro beads? It feels like that. Spread paste thinly and evenly onto the grease-free contact surfaces. Eliminates cracking noises. Oh, I guess when carbon and carbon rub, it creates a kind of noise, and this reduces that, and also this apparently reduces corrosion. Okay, alright, so I'm going to apply some to the inside of the seat post area. It's like some magic pink color paste at it. So just like that. Feels like quite a lot actually. There's so much of it, I just apply it wherever I can. Yes, you know, I've gotten so many bikes over the years, and this is the first time where I'm like kind of almost fully assembling my bike. This one's already considered partially assembled, so. But I guess for those of you who are keen on trying all these things, there's a sense of pride. You kind of build it so you know what's going on. When something breaks, you more or less have a deeper knowledge of what went wrong and how to fix it. Especially those situations where, you know, sometimes you ride a bike and then you hear weird sounds coming up. When you assemble your own bike, you kind of have a deeper sense like what should be the problem and how to fix it. Okay, so I got that part sorted out. Now, the instruction manual kind of leaps forward, it doesn't really show much. So I assume that you just put the seat post in. So I might as well just do that now. Oh, this seat post is quite intriguing. Okay, I'm gonna cut this off. Okay, something interesting here. So, oh, okay. So, this diagram which I tore off, it actually shows that you're supposed to apply that assembly paste onto the seat post as well. So I'll rub some on. Then there's a part here, if you look at the seat post, right, can you see this little nook and screw? Apparently when you adjust this, you adjust how much tension is applied so that these two parts can swivel. So this is a shock absorbing carbon seat post. It will swivel, you know, there's a pivot area here as well. And you can adjust how much of the
swiveling actions happening if you were to adjust this screw over here, because it then controls how tight the two joints are. So I guess if you loosen it a lot, this whole thing will flex a bit more. So interesting concept, but I guess this kind of thing will be hard for you to figure out until you kind of you know, you ride it and you kind of like get a hang of it. So I'm not gonna mess too much with the tension for now. I'll just apply this assembly paste for now and call it from there. Because like I said, you know, you won't know till you ride and get a feel of it. So let me just put this down. Okay, so technically, right, I was expecting this to be a bit harder, but so far most of the parts are largely assembled already, so it's not too crazy difficult. I'm gonna say almost anybody should be able to do this. So I'm just applying this assembly paste to the bottom here. So I'm doing it just below the line that says max. There's like a little gauge here. I know it's hard for you to see, but there's a little gauge here and it terminates around here. So I'm applying just below the gauge. Okay. See, even the saddle's already like screwed in already, so you know, it saves you time. And you can always adjust this part later if you really want. Like if you want to move the seat forward, backward, and all that. Okay, so now we're gonna put this in. So just a reminder, I've applied the assembly paste on the seat post as well as inside this seat post area as well. Goes in. Fairly smooth. And I'm just gonna stop just after the max area. Now some of the assembly paste started to kind of fall out, so I'm just going to use tissue paper here to wipe off. Roughly. Again, I'll probably tighten this after I assemble the bike. There's no point, right? I need to figure out the hike. Okay, so that part is done. The seat post is done. Next is, looks like it's the front wheel. So, the front wheel is here. So it's one of the first things that I took out from the box. And take this off. Again, if you joined us late, this is the Canon Grail CF, which is carbon fiber, SL8, there's like SL6, SL7, and SL8, it's different grades. And the SL8 version comes with a few nice touches, includes this carbon fiber seat post that flexes to absorb vibrations, GRX 800 group set, the brakes and all that. You can tell GRX by this massive fins to absorb the heat and dissipate the heat. So it's pretty crazy because for gravel, they expect that you brake quite a lot. So, and overheating the brakes until it turns really hot is one issue.
Okay, so at this point, right, because earlier on I mentioned to you guys that I actually have my own tires, the Pirelli, I'm in half the mind to take this off right now and put it on before I assemble the rest of the bike. That's just going to end up taking up a bit more time. So, but if I don't do it now, and I do it later, I'm kind of like going to create more work down the road. So I still have enough time till midnight because I don't want to do this all night, right? I'm going to try and take this tire off and put the new ones on. Again, if those of you who missed the earlier part, the other tire that I got is a brand new kind of tire set that runs hilariously fast, and I like it because of the aesthetic, the treading. So this is the, just so you know, this is a Shelby G1 bike, and it's a really good tire already to begin with. The treading is like these dots here that gives you a good mix of between hard terrain and mixed terrain, so it's gonna be muddy, can be whatnot. So there's a bit of knobs, yet it rolls pretty fast. There's still some sort of like tire resistance naturally, all right? But this other tire that I got, this is the one that I've become a fan of. This is the Pirelli's, you know, they make car tires, right? And this is the Cinturello Gravel H, which is hard terrain. There's also a mixed terrain. And this is 45 mm versus this, which is 40 or 38. So again, I mentioned, those of you who know me well, I love fat tires, right? So I'm trying to fit as wide a tire as possible, that is physically possible, because any fatter means you rub the frame and naturally you can't cycle anymore. So based on the Reddit forums for the Canyon Grail, some people have managed to put this on. So I'm gonna try this. Right, and this moves fast, and the tread structure, look at that, this is almost like motorbike. So I love this motor feel. There's some tires, the Shelby makes one which also has this kind of treading. It's beautiful. And I'm like, you know, this is 10 wall, right? I got it black because I wanted to match the rim, which is black too, and so I like that complete sleek look, black on black. So the whole tire, you can't tell where the rim starts and the wheel starts. They kind of blend together. So it gives you that even more fatter look as well. So I've done this with my Brompton, where I've got a pretty fat black tire to match the black rims. And it just makes the wheel look really, really fat aesthetically. So it's one of those things. So okay, I'm gonna take this off. All right, it's a bit of work. This removing of the tire bit is always going to be a bit of work. But if I don't do it now, I'm just delaying the inevitable. So I'm going to get my tire levers and all that stuff, and I hope I don't break the wheel. Give me a sec. Typically, I use two tire levers, makes it a bit easier. Let me find my other one.
actually have multiverse, but I don't know where I place them. Too many things lying around. Anyway, I'm using what I have here. So, okay, let's take these bad boys out. I hope that this will make the bike really look superb. Again, this is the Pirelli Cinturello Scrabble hard terrain version. So a lot of stuff that I buy, just to let you guys know, if you don't already know, right, Amazon Prime is the bomb. And if you're looking for stuff, sometimes Amazon Prime really gets it, for some reason it's really cheap. And with because I pay for the Prime, right, it's like, it's amazing lah. International shipping, $60 once you hit that mark. It's free shipping, right? And some of the things that go on sale there is pretty insanely, much more affordable than anywhere else. Oh, nice. Okay, so this is what it looks like. Looks giant, actually. I hope it's not too big. Tubeless as well, but I'm happy with tubeless, and I know how to patch tubes and all that, so I'm way happy with tubes, because tubeless, right, there are advantages to it, but if something really goes wrong, it can be catastrophic as well, so I don't want to deal with that. Okay, so hard for you to see, but yeah, so here you go. For me to do this, I'll need to put it on the floor naturally, so these again, I think these are 40 or 42. Let me check. These are 40. 40C. Otherwise, in other technical terms, it's 28 by 1.5. Okay, and the PSI, the bars is about maximum between 45 to 70 PSI. As for this one, where is it? Sometimes it's hard to find. And mind you, for some of these tires, they rotate in a certain way only. So you have to put it in the right direction. Up to 35 to 65 PSI. So it's less than this, which is fine, because fat tires, the whole idea is to absorb bumps, right? So typically you want to put less pressure in them. Okay, so this is 45. Yeah, 700 by 45. So technically it's about 5mm wider. And I hope it works. There is some clearance I can see for the wheel. Will be close, but should work out. At worst, I have to do it again. I won't be able to finish tonight, but at least we learned something. Okay. Let's take this off. Deflate first.
if the Cinturellos work, I'll probably sell these tires because they are pretty new, unused. The only reason, I mean, if you do keep to this, right, the advantage is if you do buy the Canyon fenders, which beautifully integrates with the frame, right, then this will fit, lah. But with the 45, it probably won't fit the fenders as well. So you have to decide and make that choice.
Okay. I think bulk of it's off.
To me, tire changing is always troublesome. Sometimes it comes off easy, sometimes it's a lot of work, it's a bit of luck. And when you buy expensive parts like these, it's very scary, sometimes you accidentally like nick them or damage. So I like to use at least two tire levers, because one to hold it and the other one to actually kind of take the rest of the parts out, rest of the tire off. Okay, so like so, got one in and one kind of like, let me actually use this one. One in, then I use this bigger one, this from Crank Brothers. Go forward, it comes off, right? There you go. On this, this is the point this way. Where's the rotation? Yeah, rotation is kind of pointing this way. I'm looking at the knobbies. The disc brake is on the left hand side. Rotation is this way, so we'll start to put it on. I'm not a pro, but I do replace tires on my own, so. I know of some folks who ride expensive bikes and they can't even change their own flats. I mean, that's, I won't say it's sad lah, but you know, some of these things, can try to do, make time to do, just do it lah. Okay, just trying to fit this in right now. That one is a bit weird, like, because this tire seems very big. I don't know if it's going to be like a problem. It's a bit confusing to me. I'm just trying to see one side of it inside the wheel rim. I'm sure there's a better way to do this, but I'm just trying to figure out how to get it in the groove. It keeps coming out for some reason. maybe I should inflate the tire first.
I don't know if there's any better advice. One thing that worries me is that because this rim is designed for up to 42, right? C, I don't know what's the tolerance level, the threshold, whether it can take in a 45. Like I said, I mean, some of these things, do research is so very hard to find answers. You just have to try. Again, it's weird because I'm trying to seat the higher in the rim, right, but it easily pops up, so I'm not very sure what's going on. I hope I don't take all night trying to figure this out. Seem to sit it in. I think what I'll do is I'll start to inflate the tire and hopefully it'll be easier to seat the tire in there. Let me get my pump. Drink. Okay. So like I said, if any of you got advice on how to seat new tires on, I'm all ears. Let me see if I can see the chat a little bit easier. No, I can't really see properly. The tire is going beyond the rim. It's a bit dangerous. But at least with the tension, I should still fit the tire on better than when it was completely flat just now. Okay, let me see if I can get this right. So I'll kind of do the same thing but in reverse to what we did just now. Instead of taking it off, now I have to put it on.
Yeah, it's not working.
Shit.
Man, this is hot.
Still gotta do the other side.
Not coming off like just now, so it appears to work, I think. It's getting a bit harder now, but we're almost done, almost there. Bit more. Okay. One side is in. Oh my god, that was tiring. Now I have to get the other side again. Imagine if you screw up, right? And to take out the whole thing again. The whole part assembly, right? This tire changing part takes up the most time.
inside and keeps coming out. Okay, somehow it's easier now. Maybe just not inflated too much air or something. Hopefully the other side is still open. Okay, a little bit more. Okay, looks like this part is levers. Do one side, the other side comes off. Hand is aching me. I feel like I should align the text a little bit better, but it's okay, it's too much work. So far it looks decent. I like that the text appears to be in silver rather than white, because otherwise it'd be too loud already. It's a bit more grayish silver. Okay, this goes in the front.
disc brakes, I remove this safety so that the disc can fit in.
Now, put this on. I don't know if you're supposed to grease it or what, but does it say anything? Keep brake system clean. Take off the safety, put on the wheel, tighten.
Okay, straightforward, just put on the wheel, tighten.
Oops.
Okay. Okay, now I put this on. Oh, okay, it's easier than I thought. Well, technology nowadays is quite advanced. This knob so that it doesn't point all directions. I'm hoping for it to kind of point up. Let me just try to unwind the one again. I might have to solve this another day. But yeah, it's just kind of weird for it to stick down like that. I wonder if there's a way to have it point up. But because if I point it up, right, it feels loose. Then when I tighten, it's up to here. So I'll probably have to figure out what the heck's going on another time. But for now, at least this part's solid. And so smooth. Okay. Great. Yeah, this technology is amazing. Alright, so that's the rear wheel. We still gotta sort the front wheel, we still gotta sort the rear wheel. Yeah. So let me see. Something in the rear wheel I'm supposed to do. Looks like the derailleur is okay. Alright, let's do the rear now. Oh, okay. Technically, this is already pre-assembled, right? All done, but because again, like I said, I want to change the fatter tire. Okay, visually, right, the 45C and the 40 don't really look that different, but maybe because I haven't fully inflated this front tire yet. All that pain for such a minor thing. Okay, well, alright, I'm gonna
gonna try and remove the rear. This is not part of the instructions, obviously. We're going off script. To improve your riding experience, your bike is very special. Oh, they even supply a little plug to cover this seat post adjuster here, so that maybe you don't get mud covering on the inside. That's pretty cool. It's probably in the assembly pack in the box. Okay, so once again, itchy fingers, have to figure out how to take this off with the derailleurs and all that stuff. And this plastic thing is called the dog disc, affectionately known as the dog disc. It's meant to prevent a chin drop from going into the spokes and then tearing up the whole spokes and stuff. If you're a normal rider, you want to take it off, but it's still a bit malu. But maybe for now, just leave it. I just need to figure out how to take out this tire, this wheel. And sometimes I get tripped by the way this thing goes. So I gotta remember how it's done. It's on the biggest chainring here, so you just gotta remember that. And it's on the smaller chainring in the front. Okay. There's a lot of force in this. I can feel that there's a lot of force put into this. This particular knob to remove the rear one. Maybe that's why the front one I can actually push it up if I use a bit more force. But I gotta learn how to do this anyway, especially on a change tire. Okay, it's moving. latch mechanism so you can turn the knob in whichever direction you want. Okay, I can now fix the front properly then. Learning as I go. Once again, this plastic thing is a dog disc. It comes with most bikes as a safety precaution, but most riders would want to remove this. And there's no easy way to get this off. The easiest way is to just get scissors or something, just cut straight through, right? So I managed to detach it from the spokes. Usually there's three areas where it sticks to the spokes. Then you kind of like just cut through. It's not too bad with a good pair of scissors. Just be careful not to cut your spokes. Alright. So I cut through and then what you do is, I know it's hard for you to see, and what you do is, see, I cut through, right, this plastic piece, and you just try to take it off, like, you know, like bend your way out. non-trained mechanic trying to do all these things. Just, you know, finagling it the way around it. Okay, so same thing. Going to take off the tie again. First, deflate tie.
Watching, but
anyway, this is the Canon Grail CF SL8, and I'm assembling it from the box, so this is an unboxing. At the same time, I'm doing a few modifications. I'm changing from the stock tires to the Pirelli's Cinturello hard terrain version gravel tires. Those are 45 mm. This the standard stock one is 40 mm. And the standard one is actually really solid. It's Shelby G1 bike at 40 mm. But you know, I like fat, so that's why. And I like bikes that are monotone. So you know, this right now it's got the gray gray bronzy look with black. And the tire, you see the front tire fixed already, it's fully black. So super uniform, not three colors, you know, like two colors. So it's like for the minimalist one. Okay, I think I deflated enough. I'm gonna take off the tires, same process. Again, like I said, hit or miss, right? Sometimes easy to take off, sometimes very difficult, really depends. I think I'm gonna do it a bit more. Okay, max out already. Get under the bead of the tire. This tire levers, right? Sometimes you try and force it up, the whole tire lever breaks. I bought metal ones as well, and you're very scared that sometimes you will break your rim also. So, this kind of situation, I don't know if there's any better way to manage it, but just have to try to coax it as much as possible. So this is a more hardcore one, right? This is from Crack Brothers. It's almost like a knuckle duster in a way. But as those of you who know, it's always easier when you use at least two tire levers to give leverage. This one's more powerful, so we should go get the first one out. There you go. And then the idea, right? For those who don't change your own tires, right? I have to do it for emergencies, lah. Kind of like just push it forward, right? It gets easier. Right now it's hard. See, you push it, then it comes off. And then this part, right, actually you don't have to hang on. Actually what you can do is, you leave it on, then you see this hook here? You kind of kick it against the spoke, right? So you don't have to hold this, you just concentrate on the other one. Wow, something that is easier. So now, once you get past the initial stage, right, you get one side off. Okay, one side, you now skip the other side. Okay, and of course I deflated tire first, was easier. Now the other side. So push it in, try to find a little groove to make it easier for you to keep the wire or the part of the tire, the bead there. So once you keep it, then it's easier to pull it off. Then again, we try and hook it against the spoke. You've got some leverage here, you've got a gap. Kind of then work your way in. And then spot, you can't pull it out. I'm not a pro, so I'm pretty sure there's easier ways of doing all of this. If you follow my way, you might damage your rims. But I'm just trying to get shit done, so yeah, okay. Alright, there you go. So anybody wants to buy my Shabe G1 bikes? For sale. Okay, so interesting, just to let you guys know since you're here, looks at the inner tube, they're using Shabe number 18 extra lights. This is rated at 28 for 44-622. So I should take a picture of this, my hands are greasy, so I'll just show you guys on screen in case you want to get exact tubes in future, because you know you have to remove your whole whatever. There you go. Okay, extra light Shabe number 18, 28/44-622. So I'm hoping that that 44 means that it can technically fill up to 44 mm. Usually there's a bit of give lah. So my other new tire is 45 mm. Okay, so we're gonna fix the new one. And for those of you joining late, I'm using the brand new Citroello Pirelli's gravel tire hard terrain version, which are supposed to be hilariously fast. And there's two versions, the hard terrain and the mixed terrain. Mixed terrain is for really, it's a bit knobbier, so it's for all kinds of situations, but it's not roll faster, alright? Okay. And as for a lot of tires nowadays, these can run tubeless as well, but I'm not a huge fan of that because I know how to fix tube tires, so I'm gonna stick to that. And like with a lot of new tires, the treading, right, they run in a certain direction, so you have to make sure that you put on the tire in the right direction, rotation direction. Okay. Yeah, I got all black instead of the tan wall. I prefer that sleek look. So now, just looking at the bike, I have to just orientate. So this brake is on that way, rotation is going to be this, based on what the tire is saying, it's this way, so the treading is this way. Okay, don't screw this up, I have to take it off and on and put it all over again, on all over again. So let's put it in there. So at first, just that first tire, right, I thought like, wow, it's like so loose, like how is it going to fit? But once you inflate the tire, the tube, right, suddenly everything gets really tight, really. So just like just now, we learned that there's no point trying to seat the tire in yet. It's better to try to fill the tire, the tube a little bit, so that adds pressure to the tire and pushes it outwards. So let's try that. Pushing out the tire in all directions now, right, the tube. So now I can try to seat one side and seat the other side. Okay, so same thing, I'm going to use all this to seat it back. one side, man.
Still got to figure out the other one. Not my favorite part about fixing a bike and all that. This tired part is quite scary sometimes because you don't know what might break.
Almost there.
Okay, so one side is in. Let's figure out the other side.
A little bit more.
You do one side and yes, it comes off.
Okay, very close screen. Just have to figure out this a little bit. up is a bit easier. I've seen some people do this before. Hopefully this method works. I see you just step down on it. Just a little bit more. Oh, that was like ridiculous, man. There's probably a better way to do all this. Yeah, Sean, if you don't know, I'm changing tires all. That's why it's beyond the script of what the instruction is providing. And I'm doing things a little bit harder than it ought to be. By right, I would have finished this like probably 1 or 2 hours ago. It's actually very intuitive, but once again, I'm doing things a bit different. Okay, at least I got this part sorted out. Let's put this back on. Okay. So the top of it is somewhat done. Wow. So replacing the tires is way, 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 way harder. The whole bike actually can be done like really fast. Okay, now we're left with pedals, inflating the tires. Then we're almost there. Let me just wash my hands a little bit because it's really messy right now. Okay. Alright. Now we're left with pedals and what else? So good. Okay, I can see the alignment's a bit off. The wheel is rubbing on one side. It's not fully inflated yet, that's why. So this is the part where, you know, there's a bit of a risk element. Yeah, I'm hoping it's just because it's not fully inflated yet. We'll see. Okay. spank pedals. Pins, where it helps you have better grip over your pedal, so they give you two spare. And these washers go with this. So I'm just going to get some grease and the pedal wrench. Best because you actually need a lot of grip lah, but this comes from my big tool kit. Then I don't really have grease, but I got this Q+ metal conditioner lubricator. So hopefully this works. The reason why you need to do this part is because next time you're gonna remove the pedals, if you don't grease it and all that, it's gonna get stuck for life, man. And then you're gonna have a hell of a time trying to change pedals or if we have to take them out. Okay, so left and right, where? I need to find the symbols or something. Oh, okay, interesting. For the spec pedals, the left one is indicated with the production code and L, while the other one has no code. So this one happens to have a code written on it. So left, is this side? Right? Yeah. Okay. So I'm gonna spray some of these. Thank you.
wrench like me that go in from the back of the pedal, and those that use a spanner like wrench, right, to go with the hexagonal nut in the front. Most of my pedals tend to be this one where you tighten from the back, because I like how flush the pedal is to the crank. So sometimes for that look, right, you kind of need to go in from the back. Those where... Okay, I hope this is right. I see you have hit the limit. Yeah, so again, it's the seamless look, but whether you want it to be close to the crank or not.
Same thing. buried in the rim. I can't read the words.
I think I remember like 35 PSI or something. That's the minimum. 35 and 60 or 70. Yes, I hit 65 PSI should be fine. What's the lower one? 36 PSI. I'll just do about 45. Barely clears, man. It's like so close, right? It's for the true seekers, lah. This is the part where, this part here, the lower part of the triangle near the bottom bracket, where 45, right, is cutting it very, very close. It's like a slice of cheese, will barely fit the side. On the upper parts here, the clearance is still okay, on the upper part of the triangle, but the bottom bracket is where it's so close, right? It's only for those of you who live life to the edge. But I kind of like the flat look. Alright. It's coming together, all the effort.
already 12:30. Sorry, this is so long.
But it's never so smooth sailing when you don't do this all the time. Okay, at least that part's the tricky part. The front usually is more forgiving. Alright, so we're gonna fill the front now. For me, PSI, I'm gonna try and hit 50 on cut. Okay. Alright. PSI, sweet spot between 36. Yet, so we'll do that. Actually, I should measure up. Yes, just make sure that the yields have no issue. The tech nowadays, I was saying, is that to calibrate the brakes, you have to align the wheel. True axles means that more or less it should be straight, lah. You won't get your wheels in it and all that stuff. And then the self-adjusting brakes are marvels of modern technology, right? So you don't have to calibrate the brakes. If everything is stored properly when you brake, it's actually going to adjust itself. Micro adjustments, pretty solid. Alright, looks like I'm almost there. So now it's just the seat. You can see it's super aggressive. So high in the bar, so probably gonna try and, to adjust this to fit. I'll probably have to ride and adjust though. But generally speaking, should just be a little bit higher than the, what you might call it, than the handlebar. Because this is not like a roadie or whatever where it's so racy. Let's go about here for now. For safety reasons, I'll just tighten a little bit. Oh shit, this thing won't fit. Now that I've got this, I'll have to use my wrench. So just to let you know, this Topic 2, right,
is like freaking amazing. Along, if you don't have this, right, it's damn good. It's a ratchet that's so small. It's really awesome, man.
Okay, so like I'm gonna calibrate this part here, tighten the seat post. Just after riding and stuff. Okay, technically it should be there. Just a few minor touches more. I've got a special, what else? I've got the bottle cage, the fitlock ones. Because I'm using like a half frame bag and you know I have to rotate the to get the, what do you call that, bottle cages, bottles out instead of straight up, so I opted to get something cleaner. Otherwise it's almost there. I'll probably have to send the bike in for, what's that thing called, the protective film, right, since it's all carbon on, then we should be good to go. Just so you know, when you get the bike right, Canyon already applies some over some sensitive areas, like where the cables are. They have one applied over the logo here. Because I remember I had another Canyon in, earlier on where the logo was rubbed off by the cable already. So I can see they already started to apply the protection film here, here, and here where the cables kind of rub. So, quite good though. Okay. I also got a few bells and whistles. Here is the Canyon integrated barbell. So I'll put this on the left side because I've got a mirror that's incoming that will fit in here as well. I like to be all well rounded. And my other favorite part is I also got this. So a lot of people who buy Canyon, right, sometimes they buy all the parts and realize that it doesn't fit. Yeah, there's some homework that needs to be done. So one guy bought this for his time trial bike. This is actually an integrated light. And even though it's so small, right, it's really damn powerful, man. You can angle this. Then it's USB-C. Damn it, it's USB-C, you know, that's how you charge it. Then it comes together as a set like this. And this thing, right, mounts to the bottom of your integrated handlebar. So it's very tidy, lah. So there's just two screws here, right? You don't have to get this, but it's just that I love the integration feature. Then this light magnetically attaches to this mount where you can put your Garmin. So this whole thing super integrated very beautifully to the handlebar. I love all these things. It's like really, really sports car or everything else super integrated. So it comes off, and then you charge your battery. So I'm just gonna mount this onto the bike since I have it right now. So there are like these two screw holes below. See, it's like super sleek, man. Then you just kind of like, I just screw a little bit in first. Okay, the other one. can attach your light below.
Jeez, magnet, but there's a catch, but they're gonna release, you press a button and you can take off the whole thing. So it's pretty safe, like won't fall off. Yeah, just to show you, right? So it's pretty bright, and then there's an indicator here. The indicator turns red, just go back. Then your Garmin goes on top. I'd say it's a good buy. I mean, you can use the other extension mounts that you can buy, and you can wrestle your own light in. But I bought one recently for my other bike, but there's too many things sticking out all over the place. So this is like very flush, very simple, very nice. Okay. Alright. I think that sums up for enough for tonight. You know, I'll just do the refinements later on, but generally speaking, this is it. And I just want to compare the wheels. It's so minimal, but I can see that this one is definitely a bit wider. So it's 55mm wider. Show you on screen. I mean, you can't really see, but it's thicker. So yeah, more comfortable because I wrote this on the green corridor, especially the Victima side, right? And it got really crunchy when it comes to the real rocks and gravel where the real weight is, and a bit of width might add a bit of comfort. Then you just run lower pressure, then you should be good to go, so you absorb the bumps. Yeah, so that should be it. Okay man, that's all for now. So thanks for watching all the way, man. And yeah, I'll put this, probably put this on sale. I don't know where I'll keep it, but I don't need this. I mean, I know a lot of people like the 10 walls, but it's a bit too noisy for me. I like the cleaner look. Yeah, okay. So I'll finish up the bike another day, just the refinements. Get it all tuned and put my fling bags and water bottles, everything on it, and so on and so forth. Then I'll let you see the final product next time. Okay, that's all for now. It's like, I think we started at about 9 something, maybe estimated 9:30. So that took me about 3 hours and 15 minutes, I think. Yeah. Actually, you can get done in 1 hour. It's just that the tire change part really took a lot of effort. Mostly my inexperience. I've changed before, but I know how tedious it is. So yeah, I'm still not pro at it. Yeah, okay, great. Thanks so much for watching. And hope you enjoyed. Thanks for staying all the way if you did. Take care. Bye-bye.